Ísland getur orðið risi á heimsvísu í hreinni orku, segir aðstoðar orkumálaráðherra Bandaríkjanna.
Hann er sannfærður að heimurinn geti lært mikið af Íslendingum á þessu sviði.
Við hittum Andrew Kerstner á máli í sendiráði Bandaríkjanna í hátæðin í dag.
Welcome, Mr. Kerstner.
Thank you. First
of all, you're meeting one of our ministers in just a few minutes' time. What's going to be the main discussion at that meeting?
Well, the main discussion is how the United States and Iceland can grow their collaboration, expand their historic friendship into new areas that bring us together for the 21st century. Clean energy production and use and consumption, how to combat the serious challenge of climate change, enhance the quality of life for our peoples, and at the same time grow our economies while reducing our impact on the earth and reducing our dependency on sources of fuels we'd like to see diminish.
From what you know, is Iceland special in some way regarding this? Is it do we have more options than other countries, or how do you see that?
Well, it's a loaded question. Of course, we all know that Iceland is special in many ways, right? But in the realm of energy, very specifically, it's special because it has almost a zero emission footprint in terms of its generation. It's a small country, but with abundant natural resources that power its economy. So hydro from its water resources, geothermal from the heat underneath it, and has managed to have large scale production. In many ways, Iceland can become the Saudi Arabia of clean energy worldwide. And so even though it is a small country, it has a larger footprint in terms of its technological prowess, particularly in the realm of geothermal and a future for hydrogen. And those are areas where we intend to grow collaboration.
Do you see this cooperation in this sector between Iceland and the States growing really much in the next years?
Oh, I think so. I think so. I'm here at the invitation of your president, who's been very active walking around the earth in most forums and touting the message of Iceland's clean energy sector and trying to engage in these science and technology relationships. And so that is really the most important thing that we do about the challenge of global climate change. The United States is the leading country in the world investing in climate change science and technology and advancing these resources. And so our friends and allies around the world who want to engage in a serious discussion about how to advance the state of clean energy technologies, we're very much trying to engage and build those relationships to advance those solutions at a faster rate.
In general, this meeting and more meetings you're having, is it a sign of the Bush administration putting bigger emphasis on these issues?
I think that's right. The president in the last two, his big speech every year is called the State of the Union. In the last two States of the Union, the president has featured prominently these issues. 2 years ago, he talked about America's addiction to oil. Last year, he talked about the serious challenge of global climate change. So when he took an opportunity to address the nation, he put the issue of clean energy, reducing our energy dependence, dealing with global climate change at the top of the agenda. Those are issues that we manage, but we know that we can't manage alone. Leadership for the 21st century means that we're going to have to get with our friends and allies, scientists around the world, some many prominent scientists in this country, and work these solutions together if we want them to arrive efficiently and in a time frame that's consequential for our problems.
You talked earlier about Bush saying America's addiction to oil. United States, they have been criticized for not respecting the Kyoto Treaty and other things. Has the United States been too self-centered in the last decades regarding energy?
Well, you're asking two separate questions. The first question is, what do we feel about Kyoto? The second question is, are we too inward-looking about energy? Let me take the second one first. Yes, the United States is a place that socioeconomically has grown up with abundant resources. Socioeconomically, we're the place on the planet that discovered oil first, that employed all the elements of an oil economy first: airplanes, cars, highway systems. I myself grew up in Texas, so you had a sense when you sent postcards of oil wells around the world to people that your energy supply was inexhaustible and that it had low impact. Okay, of course, we're finding out and discovering naturally that that's not the case. But there is a socioeconomic element to that when compared to countries that don't have the resource and are naturally have been more efficient. So there's a time curve on that. Having said that, the United States also, this year, led the world in greenhouse gas reductions at the same time that it grew its economy 3.3% and had an unemployment rate under 5%. So when you compare that to the Kyoto signatory countries that did not reduce greenhouse gases at that rate, that did not install new emission-free clean energy sources at that rate, that did not have that level of efficiency against economic growth, at some point we also have to say, we should be listening to one another. There are things that are going very right in the United States.
So I hear from you that you are quite confident that the big energy users in China, United States, and these countries are on the right way.
Well, I think we're on the right way that we begin listening to one another and stop presuming that any one party has all the solutions. The truth is, none of us have all the solutions. We're all sharing this planet together, and we're all going to have to work together to understand the problem so that we and diagnose it correctly so that we can employ the right toolkit to begin solving the problem. Kyoto has not gone very far towards solving the problem. The United States performs better than most of the Kyoto signatories in terms of its greenhouse gas reductions profile. So we have to learn, why are things working, why things don't work, what is it that we should make the best practices for everyone, and what's the timetable for implementing solutions.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me.